Mr. K.S. Wong graduated from the Department of Architecture of the University of Hong Kong. He assumed the post of the Secretary for the Environment of the Hong Kong SAR government on the 1st July of 2012. As an architect by profession, Mr. Wong has been promoting sustainable building environment since the 1990s. He served in the leading position of a number of professional bodies and organizations about a sustainable built environment in Hong Kong. During his tenure as the Secretary for the Environment, Mr. Wong has launched and updated a number of policy blueprints covering air quality, waste management, energy saving, climate actions, and biodiversity. Mr. Wong's keynote today is entitled Hong Kong's Climate Action Plan 2050. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome the keynote speaker, please.
Good morning, Chairman Leung, Professor Wei Pan, speakers, engineers, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Thank you for inviting me to attend today's very meaningful event. As mentioned by Ricky, that now we are facing crisis. Okay, that is about survival. It's a global challenge. And we have to prepare and get ready. And as mentioned by Ricky, there are problems, challenges, but we should also see its opportunities. And we see that everyone should contribute. And in particular, engineers should have an important role to play. Today, I have a presentation to share with you what is the concept behind the Climate Action Plan 2050. That was launched last year. Before that, I would like to share with you that the story started at least in 2015. At that time, as mentioned by Ricky, that held the COP15 conference. COP21 conference in Paris, attended by some 200 economies. And shortly after the 2015 global event in Hong Kong, in January 2017, Hong Kong launched our first comprehensive Climate Action Plan 2030 Plus that cover three important aspects. That is ARM, adaptation, resilience, and mitigation. Ricky mentioned a lot about adaptations, how we can make our city to be more resilient in terms of hardware to tackle the heavy rainfall, coastal, rising sea level, heat wave, etc. Resilience is defined here as the software, how we can make Hong Kong survive better during extreme weather conditions and recover better. So we need both hardwares and softwares. M stands for mitigation, that is decarbonization. In the last climate action plan, we set the target to reduce Hong Kong's carbon intensity. And following the basis of Paris Agreement, every economy should review their climate action plan periodically, say every 5 years. So we follow that pattern. But before that, I would like to further highlight that in the last climate action plan, there's a map showing various major strategies in Hong Kong covering mitigation and adaptation. For instance, on mitigation, you can see that we are phasing out the coal power plant by gas power plant as the transition with more waste energy facilities, more photovoltaic systems, and even considering wind and hydropower. District cooling system, as mentioned by Ricky, and more green buildings, and also green mobility strategies. And on adaptation, there's slope strengthening, flood control, sea level rise and coastal protection, water security, etc. In 2020, President Xi, United Nations UN, highlighted China's latest decarbonization targets. There are two. First is to reach the carbon or CO2 emissions peak before 2030, and achieve carbon neutrality before 2060. And about a month later in Hong Kong, through policy address, we declare Hong Kong's latest decarbonization target, that is to achieve carbon neutrality before 2050, about 10 years ahead the whole country. And in fact, Hong Kong has already reached our greenhouse gas emissions in 2014. And then 2 days after the policy address in 2021, we announced Hong Kong's Climate Action Plan 2050. Many of you may be aware that on that day, that Hong Kong faced extreme weather conditions that was under the typhoon Lion Rock. And in that afternoon, Hong Kong is flooded with extreme rainfall. Okay, that it could be a signal from the heaven about Hong Kong should step up our efforts on climate actions. So today, I'd like to share with you what are the concepts behind the Climate Action Plan. Many of you should have read that Climate Action Plan. It revealed what we have been doing in the past few years on decarbonization and also on adaptation and resilience. For instance, on flooding, there were many flooding ponds, bad spots in Hong Kong in the past, but have been significantly reduced over years. And we are having a working group, as mentioned by Ricky, that chaired by CEDD, to carry out studies so that we know better about Hong Kong's climate adaptation challenges, and then we can consider what are the strategies. And the latest climate action plan further highlights what are the local challenges, what are the latest strategies within the government, and how to engage stakeholders like engineers, and also what are the opportunities. And it focuses on how Hong Kong should have deep decarbonization towards carbon neutrality. In Hong Kong, there are three major local carbon emissions: electricity generation, transport, and waste. And 90% of the electricity is consumed in buildings. So there are four major decarbonization strategies in Hong Kong. That is net zero electricity generation, energy saving and green building, third, green transport, fourth, waste reduction. But I'm not going to elaborate those details because many of you should have read the blueprint. I would like to highlight the 5 I: investment, infrastructure, innovation, interaction, and integration behind the climate action plan. Let me elaborate. Before that, the climate action plan also saw the pathway of decarbonization. As mentioned earlier, in 2014, Hong Kong has already reached our carbon emission peak, and we are decreasing the overall and per capita carbon emissions in Hong Kong. In the climate action plan, we also add a midterm target, that is before 2035. Hong Kong's total carbon emissions should be reduced by 50% using 2005 as the base year. That's about investment. Over the last decade, Hong Kong has allocated over 47 billion to implement various energy saving and renewable energy measures, promote electric vehicles and vessels, and introduce waste energy and waste to resources facilities that help Hong Kong to pass the peak and further decarbonize. Not only the government, but also the private sector, for instance, the two power companies in Hong Kong, in the last and current development plans spending 10 years, the investment of the two power companies in major decarbonization projects amounts to Hong Kong dollars 39 billion. And looking ahead, there are at least four examples. For instance, in the climate action plan, we include the first ever climate budget. That is 240 billion in the next 15 to 20 years on both climate mitigation and adaptation strategies. For instance, in the current, the recent budget, we spent a lot of money on flood control and also decarbonization. Hong Kong also issued the government green bond program since 2019 and also set up a cross-agency steering group with the stakeholders in the trade on green and sustainable finance since 2020. Hong Kong will be developed as a green finance hub in the region. That means it serves not only Hong Kong, but also the whole region, because on combating climate change, we need to work together. And I want to highlight that this week, Hong Kong government just launched the first ever retail green bond. So Professor Wei Pan and Angela is here, can also help to invest in our common future. Second, about infrastructures, I understand that engineers can contribute a lot on this. And echoing the four key decarbonization strategies, I highlight four examples. We are moving ahead on net zero electricity generation. We set a target is by or before 2035, 60 to 70% of Hong Kong's electricity supply should be based on zero carbon. And before 2050, go towards 100%. Okay, that needs a lot of investment, infrastructure, engineering support, etc. We also need more low carbon green buildings, because in the process of decarbonization, it comes to have a price. So in order to reduce the overall price in terms of investment, and also to reduce individuals' tariff payment, energy saving and green buildings are important. Third, new energy transport infrastructure. Okay, we are supporting different types of electric and even hydrogen transport. We need infrastructure. And last but not least, we need more waste energy and waste to resources facilities, because at the same time, as announced in our waste blueprint 2035, we are also going towards zero landfill when we are going towards carbon neutrality. So we have an integrated mindset. First, about innovation. I'm glad to see many more academia, including Professor Wei Pan, are supporting innovation to support the decarbonization and climate actions. The government supports that transformation. For instance, in the recent years, we set up a new fund called the Green Tech Fund on decarbonization and green projects. The response has been encouraging. In the second call, there are about 100 applications from academia, research institutes, and also the private sector companies. So we welcome your support. Second is about smart meters, because we need to be a smart and innovative city. So we are working with the true power companies to change all electricity meters in town to become smart meters within 7 years. Now it's about halfway. So in the coming few years, that every meters in town will become smart meters, and we can ride on that to help individuals and companies and universities to save more electricity. Third is about the EV charging, because in Hong Kong, in order to have the total transformation of the vehicles to become new energy vehicle, we need the charging and other infrastructures. The government is going to support more EV-ready car parks. At the same time, we need to work with trade to marketize the transformation in the public and commercial car parks. Last but not least, we use smart technology to help people to do with more recycling. For instance, you are seeing more plastic beverage bottles, reverse vending machine to collect your beverage plastic bottles in time. And other is about interaction. We need to interact, like today's event is a meaningful event for the government officials, engineers, and other stakeholders to interact, to learn from others. But here I highlight four levels. One is internationally. Hong Kong is one of the steering group member, steering committee member of C40 cities, together with London, New York, Tokyo, and other major cities. We are learning from other cities so that we can accelerate the transformation. Regionally, Hong Kong hosts the annual event, Eco Expo Asia, to show the latest technologies and knowledge. So I welcome academia and the engineers and others to support the annual event so that it can serve Hong Kong and also the region. Hong Kong is also one of the Greater Bay Area cities. So we are sharing similar contacts, et cetera. So we need to have the closer regional collaboration on various issues in relation to climate change. Lastly, I would like to highlight the task force is an internal task force, because in order to support innovation and transformation, we need to deregulate or to modernize our regulations and planning, et cetera, to support the transformation. This example is about hydrogen technology application in Hong Kong. So now, early last year, we set up a task force involving people from not only from Environment Bureau and DPD, but also involving engineers, town planners, and also people from FSD to regulate the fire safety, et cetera. We could learn from other experts on hydrogen globally, regionally, and locally. With the knowledge back up, then we can have high confidence to push ahead various innovative and emerging technologies like hydrogen vehicles, hydrogen buses application in Hong Kong. So that's why we dare to mention in our climate action plan launched last year that within 3 years, Hong Kong would see hydrogen double-decker buses and commercial vehicles in Hong Kong. And I think that task force can also serve other purpose if we are going to support more emerging technologies and innovations in town. Integration. Ricky also mentioned about integration. That's very important. Last year, we launched 4 environmental blueprints on waste, on electric vehicles, popularization, on air quality, and on climate. They are all integrated together. It's the first time within the government in Hong Kong to put them together. For instance, in order to reduce waste, it also helped Hong Kong to achieve carbon neutrality. Similarly, on vehicle, we set the midterm and the ultimate target before 2050 to phase out the conventional vehicles, that not only to improve air quality, but also help Hong Kong to meet the carbon neutrality challenge. So it's an integrated mindset in terms of the policy setting. So that brings us to the yearly roadmap, okay? Many of you should have read that. I would like to highlight a few key points. For instance, Hong Kong has been leading on electric private cars. When we launched the EV roadmap, according to the data of 2020, 1 out of every 8 new private cars was EV. That was already the highest ratio in the entire Asia. By now, say last year, increased to 1 out of 4. And the good news is that in the first quarter this year, increased to 1 out of 3. So Hong Kong is one of the leading world cities in the world to support electric private cars popularization. But we need to do more because many air pollutants are emitted from commercial vehicles and franchise buses. So we are having the new energy transport fund to support that. And we did also have the infrastructure supported by engineers to support the transformation in terms of infrastructure. So we are having the private charging infrastructure and also public charging infrastructure. At the same time, Full Green Tech Fund, we support research and applications on hydrogen technologies, application in Hong Kong, and also electric vehicles, batteries, recycling technologies. As mentioned earlier, we'd like to have the synergy. For instance, in the last decade, Hong Kong's major air pollutants have been reduced by about 40 to 60%. It's not easy, but we are doing that. At the same time, we decarbonize. For instance, in 2014, Hong Kong's FH per capita carbon footprint was 6.2, but by 2020, down to 4.5. And according to our roadmap, by midterm, that means before 2035 and by 2050, we would further decarbonize the per capita and overall carbon footprint in Hong Kong. And integration is important. So that's why the latest climate action plan highlighted what are the key challenges locally, cost of decarbonization. Space constraint. We need technological breakthrough. We need people. So it's good Professor Wei Pan and other academia would help Hong Kong to train the relevant talent to meet the challenges. And on decarbonization, we need the participation for all to help to save energy and to reduce waste. While there are problems and crises, we see the opportunities. As mentioned earlier, Hong Kong will become the green finance hub to serve the whole region. And there will be green economies as we invest in infrastructure and engineering works. We need technology and innovation. We need the capacity building, that means about people. And we would like to build carbon neutral communities. For instance, last year, the government announced the Northern Metropolis. We aspire to make all the major new development areas in Hong Kong to become carbon neutral. So that means it's not only sustainable, but also livable and to be healthy. So we have shown our in the last climate action plan that the map of the major decarbonization and adaptation investment in Hong Kong. So after a few years, here I add the new investments that are happening in the last few years and in the coming years ahead. For instance, as I mentioned, the major new development areas would be the carbon neutral communities. So we need the architects, time planners, engineers to work together in a smart and innovative way to achieve that aspiration. We are having a more distributed solar PV systems in Hong Kong, as we are having the FIT, the feed-in tariff. Before the feed-in tariff, there were only about 200 PV projects in the power center in Hong Kong. But by now, say through the FIT's over 3 years support, we are having 100 times more of the distributed PV system in Hong Kong. 20,000 projects have been making the application, and many of them have been implemented that can support all household electricity demand in the entire central and western districts, including Hong Kong US Westerns. Okay, that's a significant move. We are having more large-scale floating solar PV by water supplies department that need engineers and other people to support. We're having the floating LNG terminal in the southern part of Lantau that can help Hong Kong to capture more affordable and cleaner fuel from around the world. We are working with power companies on offshore wind farms and also application of green hydrogen in Hong Kong. We are supporting the autonomous transport system. One of the examples is by the Airport Authority that would be in town in a few years' time. We are working also on the waste energy facility, IPAX, food waste facility to energy, et cetera. And on adaptation, drainage service department are working on improvement works on flood control capacity. And also as mentioned by Ricky, CDD has just completed a study on improvement works under the coastal hazard study, and we are going to implement those projects. So we are seeing that we are having more infrastructure investment on both mitigation and adaptation works in Hong Kong. Let me show some pictures to illustrate the examples. That is the first ever floating solar PV by WSD in Hong Kong. The story is that it was built before the two super typhoons attacked Hong Kong in the recent years. It survived with minimal damage. So we learned from that, and we will expand the application of floating PV panels in WSD's water bodies in the coming years. That is the latest picture taken this month. Is the third restaurant in Hong Kong with the floating PV, and we will expand the locations and also their capacity. Other departments are also supporting the transformation. And another example is the DSD, Drainage Service Department. They're integrating the renewable energy systems in their facilities, not only PV, but also waste energy. A recent example is the floating PV in the floodwater storage pond. So the message that we should integrate all these decarbonization and adaptation strategies in an innovative way. For EPD, Environmental Protection Department, we're building the largest waste energy facility in Hong Kong, next to the Sekujiao Island. There were various challenges. For instance, it's facing the Southern Ocean. So in recent years, we made a study how to make its seawall to be adaptive to extreme weathers in Hong Kong. At the same time, the seawall also integrate the eco-SOR-like concept. That means for the reclamation with seawall that can provide the ecological habitat to the sea wildlife. So that means the integration is not only about to make the structure more climate adaptive and resilient, but also can integrate ecological considerations. To conclude, there are real challenges, but there are also opportunities. I trust that with the support of engineers, we can meet our vision of the Climate Action Plan 2050, that is go towards zero carbon emissions and make our city more livable and create jobs and economy through sustainable development. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Professor Wei Pan.